Aviara, how's it going? You're muted, by the way.
Oh, hi. Sorry.
It's all good.
How are you doing tonight? Oh.
Good. How are you?
Oh, fantastic. Oh, it's so nice to talk to you.
For sure. What's up?
Well, oh, my goodness. What is up indeed? The last couple days have been absolutely bonkers. And I was just wondering, like, what your thoughts were about that.
I mean, that's a huge question, right? Given everything that's happening.
Like, okay, let me narrow it down.
Yeah.
Do you think that, like, this so-called, you know, riots or protests or, you know, those people that stormed the Capitol building, are they comparable to what we've been seeing in the last 7 months? The whole BLM...
Oh,
right stuff.
No, I wouldn't. I don't think that they're really that comparable, right? Like a historic, wide sweeping protest movement for like racial equality. I don't think is comparable to a bunch of people who live in like this alternate reality where the election was rigged by some shady organization that spans the entire United States. Being incited by the president to storm the Capitol building and occupy it for the first time in 200 years. I think that this is very different in my mind.
Wow. Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah. I mean, that was pretty crazy.
Yeah. I mean, like the whole context around it, like, makes it like wildly different to me, I think.
Perhaps. I mean, you do know a few months ago, a bunch of people stormed the Senate building back in Portland.
Oh yeah, I like it's definitely like the case that there have been like different state houses occupied or invaded, right? Like that happened in, I believe, in Michigan too. Like a bunch of armed people got into their Senate building, but like when we're talking about the nation's capital, I think that is very different. Like, this is a place that's supposed to be the most secure location in all of America. And people were able
I
to
know.
Just run in and, like, they got, like, Nancy Pelosi's laptop. And, like, well, at first, like, it might be like, oh, that's super lulzy.
Oh,
she,
you heard about that now, did you?
She has access to top secret, like, military and, like, intelligence. Like, the fact that, like, people could just like run in and get access to government secrets is like absolutely wild.
Right? Like, that's so bonkers. Oh my lord. I cannot believe that, what was it, like two or 300 people actually went into the Capitol and they were doing all that crazy stuff. I mean, my goodness.
You know, yeah.
When it comes to like a peaceful protest, okay, sure, you could like sit on the steps and like do a sit-in, you know, like that's what people should be doing.
Mm-hmm.
But no, they actually like went into the building, and the fact that Nancy Pelosi was dumb enough to leave her laptop in her office and all these people.
Well, I don't think they exactly had time to like go get their valuables and stuff, right? Like they were in session when they got stormed. They were in the room,
yeah,
as people
exactly.
were outside. Like they couldn't go and get their laptops from their offices.
Yeah, you're right. They had to evacuate immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And like they didn't even have enough law enforcement to be there. I think there was what, like maybe a dozen cops that were just standing out there, and they couldn't stop it.
Yeah, well, and then we have video of, like, some cops just, like, standing aside and letting people through and, like, or, like, taking selfies with some of these people. And, like, it really does make you wonder, like, just how secure do cops make you, you know?
Well, that's another thing, though, because a lot of these protesters, they support, you know, Blue Lives Matter and all
oh, yeah.
that, you know, like, of course, like, you know, the cops are kind of on their side for the most part, So they're like, okay, well, I'm gonna go storm the Capitol. And the cops are like, all right, well, I also support Trump, so I don't really care. I'm not gonna shoot you, or I'm not gonna do anything.
Yeah.
And they kind of just let that stuff happen.
Yeah, I mean, like, cops are pro these protesters right up until one of those protesters, bashes one of their colleague's skulls in with a fire extinguisher, which is what happened to kill that cop that died.
Whoa, I did not hear about that. Wait.
Oh, yeah.
You're saying a cop actually died from, bashed by a fire extinguisher?
Yeah, they...
Really?
Yeah, they, they had to evacuate, I think about a dozen or so cops who had been injured by the protesters, and one of them went on to die the next day from being bashed in the head with a fire extinguisher. It was confusing because it was reported early before he died, but then he actually died.
Right, like the next day, like when he was in the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow. No, I didn't even hear about that.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, that's horrible.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
Ew.
Yeah, and I mean, like, that's probably a part of the reason why, like, the FBI is now, like, going out and rounding up some of these people who identified themselves on camera as, like, entering the Capitol building.
Okay, so, did you hear that there was some Antifa that infiltrated the protesters and they were the ones that committed a lot of violence?
I mean, I heard that from people, but I haven't seen anything that substantiates those claims.
There was a BLM member that was... It is on Twitter. It was posted just a couple hours ago. You didn't see it?
No. Send it over.
Go to Twitter. Hopefully this doesn't
I'm taking this with a hefty dose of skepticism, right? Because
absolutely.
Yeah.
But here's the thing though. It does make sense. You know, I'm sure couple of people. Of course it does. Yeah.
Wait, but like Antifa doesn't usually like show up to Trump rallies on the off chance that those Trump rallies are going to storm, like, a Capitol building or something.
Yeah, but, like, once, you know, like, it's known, like, on Facebook, on Twitter, once, you know, Trump himself says, on January 6th, let's go to the Capitol.
Yeah.
Of course Antifa's gonna be there. Do you think protesters, there's counter-protesters.
Do you think Antifa were the ones... like printing shirts that said like Civil War January 6th on them? Or do you think those were Trump supporters?
Hard to say. I mean, I don't want a civil war.
Right, but who are the people who usually talk about wanting a civil war?
Antifa.
No.
Yeah. BLM.
No, BLM doesn't talk about wanting a civil war. They talk about not wanting to be killed by police.
Well,
like, people like Tim Pool are the ones pushing civil war, and Tim Pool's, like, a conservative person.
Tim Pool is, oh my god, he's, like, such a fence-sitter, he's such a...
Oh, he's definitely not a fence-sitter. He called the election 49 states in favor of Trump. That was his prediction.
Right?
Like, he's not a fence-sitter, he's very... He maintains like the veneer of being like a moderate liberal, but he's like his entire rhetoric is geared towards conservatives and being conservative. Kind of like
I always thought he was like a liberal. Like that's what he always says. He's like, oh, yeah. I'm a centrist liberal, and I know he did vote for Trump. Actually, it's crazy because like a few months ago. Like, he was like, oh, I'm never gonna vote for Trump ever. And then all of a sudden he came out and he's like, yup, I will now. And I'm like, whoa. Seriously?
Yeah, I mean, look, if you're voting for Trump, you're not a liberal, right? I think we can agree on that.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
You're not like anywhere close to the left if you're voting Trump.
Yeah, I don't even know what he's on about. But yeah, that's pretty crazy.
Very crazy.
When it comes to the whole shirts thing,
mm-hmm.
Look, I don't know who made those things. It could have been some random person who was just trying to capitalize on the violence, on the division. It could have been anyone. You know,
so, but like, are you saying like Antifa was planning to storm the Capitol building while posing as Trump supporters?
No, I'm saying...
Even though the Proud Boys said that they were going to show up posing as Antifa?
No, I'm not saying any of that. I'm saying, like, that wasn't even the plan for anybody, I think. You know, when it comes to the Proud Boys or Antifa or BLM or...
But wait, they printed... Someone printed shirts. It was a plan for somebody.
Well, yeah, someone did. And they obviously want to capitalize on that, and they just want to stir up division, but that has nothing to do with any kind of political message. You know, they just want to make money. I mean, hell, wouldn't you?
Well, yeah, but like somebody has to order those shirts.
Well, yeah. Yeah. Sure.
So like, I don't know. I feel like conservatives are more prone to like ordering a shirt that is like endorsing a civil war, like for Trump. Right?
No.
Have you seen, like, conservative merchandise? Like, during the 2016 election, they were making, like, shirts about, like, grabbing Hillary's pussy and, like, selling them outside of his rallies.
Ew!
Yeah.
Who did that?
Well, it was, like, around the time, like, Grab 'em by the Pussy came out.
Yeah. I know the whole thing, but... They actually made shirts about that?
And like conservatives watch a lot of media where they're like, oh man, there's gonna be a civil war. Like, again, Tim Pool made like 50 videos about how there's an impending civil war. Like, it became a meme that like Tim Pool was always talking about civil war.
He has been, yes.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
He's definitely been talking about civil war, at least like for the past, I don't know, like 8 months probably.
And like, I don't know like what lefty media you take in, if any, but like those of us on the left aren't really talking about like civil war as like being a real thing at all.
No, I don't think like civil war is gonna happen. Like, that's a little crazy.
I mean, I would say it's a little crazy, but also we just had like thousands of people like occupy the Capitol building unexpectedly.
Yeah, well, for the last 7 months, we also had BLM, you know, burning down Portland. So,
I mean, is Portland gone?
There was also the Chaz. Oh, $2 billion in damage.
Wait,
it's
but that
gone.
number is spread across all of the United States, though. That's not just Portland.
Okay, $2 billion? Is that okay?
I mean, it's not great, but also, like,
yikes,
do you know that all of
big.
That damage was from BLM?
Yes.
Because
it was.
I'm going to point you to, like, I live near Minneapolis, and the burning of the Minneapolis 5 precinct and the fires that sprouted out around that are being attributed to Boogaloo Boys who are currently awaiting trial. So... Like, that wasn't BLM. Those were counter-protesters that burned down the Minneapolis police precinct.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow. Interesting.
And, like, I also have, like... I bring this up sometimes, but Harvard released one of their top researchers on, like, terrorism and civil unrest... released part of a study. I think the rest of it's going to be published soon. I think it got delayed because of COVID reasons, but their findings indicated that around 97% of BLM protests were actually peaceful, with the remaining percentage being either a minuscule amount from protesters or...
I've seen that statistic before. Yes,
or being attributed to counter-protesters or police.
Yeah, sure. That's all nice and well and good. 97%, so they say.
Yeah. I mean, well, do you have data to back up, like, a different view? Because, like, otherwise we're just arguing about feelings, yes. Right?
Oh, no, of course not. I'm not arguing about feelings at all. I'm just saying, like, there's been so many fires. There's been so many flipping over police cars.
Yeah.
All of that. And that's the 3%.
Yeah.
It's pretty bad.
Yeah, I'm not saying that's good. But do you not think, like, being angry to the point of doing, like, of flipping a car might be justified if, like, a certain community is being targeted and killed with, like, the killers not being brought to justice?
Well, I guess I would say the same thing about, you know, you. If we storm the Capitol building, are we not justified in doing that as well?
Wait, what would justify that?
Well, what would justify smashing the windows of Starbucks?
Well, I mean, again, police murders. And, like, trying to say, hey, why don't we do something about police murders? What message is storming the Capitol sending? What are they protesting for?
I think it was just to make a point. You know, it's
what was the point?
It kind of reminds me of what Martin Luther King did when he went to Washington D.C. Also, mm-hmm. You know, all of his supporters they had a sit-in, like right in front of the Capitol, like right in front of the Washington Monument.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah.
Wait, did they occupy the United States Capitol? And, like, break down
the doors and cause
Congress to have to retreat into hiding?
They had a sit-down. They were there for, you know, civil rights. They wanted to make a point.
What civil rights were the people invading the Capitol
this week? In 1960?
No, invading the Capitol this week, yeah. What were they trying to get?
Well, from what I understand, it seems to be, like, a lot of people were very angry that the election was stolen.
Was the election stolen, though?
So they say.
Yeah. Yeah. Was it stolen?
I think so.
You think so?
Yeah.
Wait, why? Because, like, I think this is a fundamental difference, right? Like, I don't think the election was stolen, so to me it looks like a bunch of unhinged people who don't live in, like, the same reality that most people in the country do, storming a Capitol building, killing a police officer, and getting protesters killed.
Well, the Capitol building does belong to the people, of course. You know,
yeah, but it belongs to all of the people. Is it okay for, like, a small minority of people to run in and break it and steal valuable, like, national intelligence?
Wait,
how do you know that those were Antifa people that were doing that?
Because they were seen at BLM.
What about
protests?
What about the people who had, like, QAnon tattoos, who have been seen at QAnon rallies? What about, like, Baked Alaska filmed himself going into the Capitol building? Nick Fuentes filmed himself going into the Capitol building.
You don't like Nick Fuentes?
Well, Nick Fuentes is like a neo-Nazi. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. His rhetoric aligns very neatly with neo-Nazis.
He's not a neo-Nazi.
I mean, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Come on. That's silly. That's very silly to me.
No, it's really not. But, like, no, his rhetoric very much aligns nicely with neo-Nazis.
Okay, so...
Oh, and, like, apparently he literally said he was there?
Wait, so he, like, he was there? Like, he was...
Yeah, he streamed himself. There are pictures of him there. So did Baked Alaska was also live streaming himself. Like, you can't tell me these people are, like, Antifa members when they're, like, participating in it.
Oh, no, they're not. And I'm not saying that, like, everyone's, you know, completely innocent. Like, that's crazy. Like, why would I even say that?
But you're, like, that's implying nuts. That, like, most of this violence was caused by Antifa, and I don't know where you're getting that impression?
Well, there was that one guy who dressed up as, like, some Nordic with the horns and all that crap.
Do you know what the tattoos on his body were?
Enlighten me.
One of them, I believe, is called, like, the Volnut. It's like, three interlocking triangles. It's well known for, like, its role in, like, Germanic paganism. But more recently, it's become more well known for its role in white supremacist organizations. And that guy has also participated in QAnon, like, right-wing protests in Arizona. There's other pictures of him holding, like, pro-Q signs. He's literally known as the Q Shaman.
I don't think that white supremacists are prevalent.
Well, I don't think so either, but we were talking about this one guy.
Well, yeah, well, this one guy. Yeah, he's clearly a radical, crazy dude.
Yeah. Wait, do you not think it's radical and crazy to storm the U.S. Capitol?
I mean, is it radical and crazy to burn down Walmart?
I mean, yeah.
That's what BLM did. So
wait,
yeah,
but like,
I think
wait,
that's pretty
are you attributing that to all of BLM? Because I'm not talking about all conservatives. I'm just talking about the people who stormed the Capitol.
Well, as far as I know, they didn't actually really like do anything.
Wait, five people died. They bashed a cop's skull in so hard he died.
The police they shot people.
Yeah.
A couple of them died of heart attacks and strokes and stuff.
Yeah. While they were invading the US Capitol. Like, I don't know. It seems pretty radical to me to invade the U.S. Capitol and bash a cop's skull in with a fire extinguisher.
Well, that definitely does send a message. You're absolutely right about that.
Oh, for sure.
That is... Whoa. The Capitol? Holy bonkers.
Yeah. It's pretty bonkers, I agree.
Yeah, I'd say so.
And five people dying, too.
I thought it was four.
No, five with the cop.
Oh, yeah, because he died later on. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Hmm. No one should have died. I mean, that's always tragic.
Yeah, I agree. Wait, who are the Antifa members?
Well, the guy who bashed in the glass, the window, into the Capitol.
And
you know who that was?
Why do you think that he's Antifa?
Because his face was referenced back into a protest that he did like 2 years ago, and it was at an Antifa protest.
Can you like provide like some evidence of that?
You haven't seen it?
Well, I mean, because like I could say that like I saw a video on Twitter of like a Trump supporter like raping five people, and like I wouldn't know
if
that was true
not
or not.
True, though.
Well, yeah,
no,
it, obviously
it's true.
Obviously it's not true, but like again, like
yeah, but
you saw something
is.
On Twitter doesn't necessarily mean that it's true. So like I just want to be able to check it out. If you can you can post it in the chit chat, and I can look at it.
Okay, well, I'm not gonna post it, like, right this second, because I'm just chatting, but, yeah.
Okay.
I'll send it to you.
Yeah.
I will send it to you.
I'd appreciate that.
I'll send you that, and also, I'll send you the BLM member who is also there, and, that just came out, yesterday.
Wait, so like, even if we grant that both of these people that you said are Antifa and BLM, That's two people out of like thousands.
Yeah, exactly. And yet,
wait, are you saying these two people did all of the violence and the rest of the thousands were just like standing there?
Yep. Yeah.
Because I covered it for 14 hours the other day. It sure looked like it wasn't just two people.
Well,
it sure looked like the rest of the crowd was participating.
Well, that's how it is. I mean,
wait, did Antifa also build the noose outside of the Capitol?
What? No.
Yeah, there was a noose outside the Capitol building.
Yeah, okay.
No, there's a picture of it. I can find it if you want.
That's fine. I'm just saying, look at, you know, hell, with Antifa, right? Like, there's sometimes thousands of people that come out to protest. And there's only a couple people that do some violence, right?
Wait, why does Antifa show up?
No. I'm just saying, in general, right? Sometimes there are some Antifa members that, you know, pop up and they protest, they do their thing, and that's all well and good.
But wait, why do they protest in general?
I'm saying this happened like years ago, okay?
Oh, okay.
And yet, there's maybe one or two people, maybe three people, mm-hmm. that do some violence. And then everyone's like, oh, wow, look at Antifa doing that violence. Mm-hmm. But the vast majority is just there to just chill out and be peaceful protesters.
Yeah. Wait, but do you think it's peaceful to invade the U.S. Capitol?
No.
Yeah, so the people who were doing that weren't being peaceful, were they? And that's not a minority of people, it was a massive crowd of people.
It was a few people. Yeah.
We could say it was a few people, yeah.
I mean, I would say it was a few people that smashed up one window or...
Wait, you think only one window got destroyed?
Yeah.
Because, like, you know that's not true, right?
But other people just walked in and they just stood there.
Yeah. And they weren't supposed to be in there. They were breaking the law by going in there in the first place.
No, they were not.
Yeah.
This is a public
building.
Do you
think that if the government fences off a building and has several layers of security and you break through all of that security and walk into the building that security was protecting, that you're supposed to be there? If you had to climb over like three fences that were securing a location, do you think that you were allowed to be at that location?
They were having a vote. However,
yeah.
The police allowed people to be in there. In fact, I don't know if you
police evacuated the building. That's different than police allowing people to be there. They gave up
the
building as
lost. They
yeah.
opened the gates. They
after,
let people in.
After part of their perimeter was already breached.
Okay. So are they not allowed to be there? Like, why
would that be an intrusion? Wait, are you saying that, like, they were... The layers of security were only meant to keep a certain kind of people out, not, like, a right-wing mob? Like, what? I'm confused here.
They should have had more security at the Capitol building.
Yeah, if we can agree on that, right? If we can agree that there should have been more security, does that not imply that these people should not have been there in the first place?
Oh, that's a complex question.
I don't feel like it is.
Well, if they did have more complex security, yeah, they should have. Like, it's literally the Capitol building.
Yeah.
Right? Like, and it's not only that. That day, they were voting to certify the electoral votes.
Yeah.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's important. So, okay. Yeah, there should have been more cops there. And
yeah.
yet, I think that American patriots who... We own this building.
Wait. But I also own that building. And I disagree with their right to be in it. And disrupting Congress and causing property damage and stealing national secrets. So, like, and I think I'm with the majority of this country when I say that. So, like, if it is the people's building, right, and we do live in a democracy, does that not mean that, hey, maybe a minority of people don't have the right to break into the Capitol building and invade it and stop Congress from certifying the election?
I think they wanted to go in there to make a point.
What was that point?
The point was to say, hey, we are here and we do not agree with what you're trying to do, trying to steal the election. And we support Donald Trump and that's it. Like, that's what they were trying to do.
So... What if the majority of this country...
That's why they were there.
But what if the majority of this country doesn't agree that the election was stolen?
Well, that's good for them, but they weren't there at the Capitol.
Right, they weren't. Does that make it okay to invade the U.S. Capitol?
Didn't say it was okay.
I mean, you said that they were allowed to be there.
But yeah, like, that's literally, like, we pay for that building.
All of us do.
All of
so
us citizens.
So the majority of people should have a say over what happens to that building in a democracy, right?
We should.
So,
but
like...
I don't necessarily...
Because, like, there were also people showing up at the building with, like, zip ties, right? And, like...
Zip ties? What?
Yeah. There are photographs of people going through, the house with zip ties. I don't think there's any reason to bring zip ties unless you're planning on taking hostages. There were also pipe bombs found on the premises. One guy was arrested, I think, with like a whole cargo of like pipe bombs. The DC police reported finding a large stash of Molotov cocktails. This doesn't imply to me that this was like a peaceful thing to make a point, and it seems to imply to me that there was some intent here. Yeah, like we're literally looking at
Yeah, well, I mean, Antifa is completely organized. They've already seen this on Facebook, like they know, and you know Facebook's not gonna ban them. Right?
Okay, but you haven't been able to show that, like, Antifa was actually involved in this at all.
Of course they were!
But you saw...
I told you this!
But your evidence was you saw a post on Twitter.
It's not my post.
It was
from a news organization.
What news organization?
Oh my god. Do I have to send you both of them?
Yeah, I would love to see them.
Alright, well. I wonder if Twitter actually banned that right now. They probably did. Anyways. I will send you both of those.
Okay. I'd appreciate it.
I'm not trying to, like, you know, be mean or, like, argue or anything.
No, we're just having a discussion. It's fine.
Yeah, of course. It's just... This stuff has been kind of crazy.
Yeah.
Actually, a little bit scary, like, to be honest.
Well, yeah, a bunch of people invading the U.S. Capitol is pretty scary for the first time in 200 years.
Yeah, right? That's messed up.
Yeah. Pretty
messed up. The last time that happened, I think it was the British army that came in and they burned that shit down.
Yeah, from Canada.
Yeah.
Damn Canadians.
Yikes. Ah, fuck it.
But yeah, I mean, like, yeah, I don't know. What else did you want to talk about on this topic?
Well, I guess I just wanted to ask you about that, you know, just, you know, see your opinion and all that.
Oh, well, I mean,
it's okay.
Yeah, my opinion is that, like, Donald Trump, like, deliberately weakened DC security, delayed the, like, assembly of the National Guard, and was setting this up as kind of a light coup attempt, or at least an attempt to intimidate Congress. And
yeah,
like, directed his people to take a walk down Pennsylvania Avenue, directing them to the Capitol building. And I think that by now he's pretty well aware that his words have effects on people. And it's hard for me to imagine that this was done in ignorance.
Yeah, sadly we lost.
Yeah.
So that sucks.
And he conceded too. How do you feel about that?
Well, I feel like Biden is not going to last very long. He's not very bright.
Why don't you think he's going to last very long?
Because he has dementia. He has no idea where he is half the time.
I don't know. Wait, but he put out a statement before Trump did yesterday. Or not yesterday, but Wednesday. The 6th. Whatever day that was.
Yes. Well, I also did hear that Corn Pop was a bad dude.
Well, did you also hear that Joe Biden's old nickname was Shoe Leather?
Pressure. Yeah. Biden's not okay.
I mean, yeah, but neither is Trump, right? Like, Trump is kind of wild.
Kamala's probably gonna be, like, the next president. Like, to be fair, she probably is.
Yeah. I mean, that's how,
and, like,
that's what the vice president is for.
True. Very true.
Like, if Donald Trump had died, Mike Pence would be president.
Yeah. Well, at least he's not freaking Kamala. What a witch.
Why do you say that?
Well, she did imprison 2.5 million black people because of nonviolent drug offenses. So yeah, I think she's kind of a fuckwit.
Yeah. But wait, that, why, you know. how do you feel about Donald Trump, like, perpetuating that, right? And expanding it to, like, privatized like, internment camps, I guess, for immigrants?
What you mean, like, when? What?
Yeah, I mean, like, Donald Trump, like, incarcerated more, like, undocumented immigrants than, like, ever before, in privatized, like, internment camps.
Yeah, he actually didn't, though. Obama did, and
well,
he
but
deported.
They weren't, but at the very least, they weren't privatized,
more.
Right? Because, like, the Trump administration.
They were.
Well. Wait, do you not think it creates, like, a weird incentive to, like, get more and more people into these camps if they're run at a profit?
No, actually, I think it's even worse if it's more federal, because they have government contracts. When it's more privatized, they don't have an incentive to get government contracts and get, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars to increase.
Wait, are you saying they don't have a profit motive? If they're privatized, wouldn't that mean that they're more motivated to get more people into their camps?
No. They're not.
Because,
no,
like, they get paid per person. It's like privatized prisons. They get paid the more people are in there, too.
Right, but privatized prisons, they have government contracts. It's federal.
But, like, per person.
The state.
Wait, is it federal or from the state?
I mean, federal money goes to the state and then the state gives it to the prison. So yeah, it's kind of both.
Yeah. So if they're run at a profit, does that not mean that like these places are making more money off of taxpayers to imprison people for longer? Because, like, you know these organizations have, like, lobbyists, right? Like, they lobby the government to pass laws.
Oh, and, yes. And I know. Yes, yeah. They do.
And so those laws that they lobby for are to incarcerate more peaceful prisoners for longer periods of time, because then they can make more money.
Yeah, well, that's exactly what Joe Biden and Kamala Harris did.
But my point is that, like, that's what Donald Trump has actively encouraged, too. One of his main contributors was privatized prison companies.
No, he didn't. He never did that.
Well, but Obama, like, outlawed privatized prisons, and Trump unoutlawed them.
Trump never did that. He never...
Wait, then why do we have privatized concentration camps for immigrants? Under Trump.
I'm not sure what you mean. You talk about those things on the border?
Yeah, the camps they made for undocumented immigrants. Those are privatized.
Oh, yes! The things that were made in 2010 under the Obama administration.
Yeah. If they're privatized, wait, does it not make it bad if Donald Trump doesn't stop them? Because, like, he's been president for 4 years, right? He had plenty of opportunity to put an end to them, but he didn't. And, like, I'm not an Obama stan. I hate that Obama did that. But it's also pretty bad that, like, Trump didn't put a stop to it. Right?
I wonder how complicated that actually is. You know, like, what he has to do. If he did want to stop it, and who he has to talk to, and what kind of contracts, or what's going on, how much money is involved. Yeah. Maybe he couldn't stop it.
Well, but, like, he took money from these, like, companies. So...
Well, he didn't deport as many people as Obama did.
Well, yeah, but that's because the people who weren't deported got put in camps for profit.
Profiting who? That's
yeah, the
just
private
a liability.
The private companies that run those camps.
So, you don't actually like Obama?
No.
What about Biden?
I'm not a big fan of Biden either. I just think he's better than Trump.
I'm a socialist.
Like neither of these people are good. I'm going for the least bad option.
That is a very good point.
Yeah.
I'm not a socialist.
That's
sorry.
Fine. I don't demand everyone bow to my political ideology. That's fine.
Yeah, but you know, I think we can all respect different ideas and stuff like that.
For sure.
No. I'm not a socialist, though.
I mean, that's fine. A lot of people I talk to aren't socialists. I don't go into conversations expecting other people to be socialists.
Really?
Yeah.
I assume that you had a lot of friends who are about that.
Oh, yeah. I do have a lot of friends who are about that, but, like, not all my friends are. Are all of your friends, like, whatever political ideology you are?
What do you think I am?
I have no idea. I'm not going to make an assumption. You can tell me if you want.
If I did, you'd probably block me and not want to talk to me again, so...
No. I don't block people who are respectful. That's fine.
Okay. Well, I'm not a racist or an ethnocentrist or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a fascist.
Okay. That's interesting. Wait, why are you a fascist?
Because I believe in a totalitarian single-party state for effective government, and political parties are absolutely stupid.
Wait, so you know Nick Fuentes is like neo-Nazi adjacent at the very least, right?
I'm not a neo-Nazi, okay?
No, like, no, but like I'm just nuts. Like I'm just I didn't say that you were. I'm just saying like you know that he is.
I guess.
Okay.
Maybe.
All right. I'm cool. Well, like I've literally talked with people who are like, oh, women should be like slaves in some sort of anarcho-communist utopia.
Whoa! Like that's crazy.
Yeah, it's super crazy.
Okay.
Look, so like,
when it comes to fascism, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I think that having multiple parties disenfranchises a lot of people. That democracy is just the illusion of freedom. That your one vote, it doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Because politicians, they adhere to their lobbyists, their corporate donors. They don't care about us.
Mm-hmm.
They don't.
Yeah.
And there should be one single party state that has effective government that doesn't shut down when it comes to economic, especially like the budget. Oh my goodness. Like, how many times has the United States government shut down?
Can I ask, like, wouldn't it make like the government more susceptible to like capitalist influence if there was only one political party?
I don't see that as a bad thing. I mean, sure.
Wait, but like you just said that like in like a democracy, right? Like it's corrupted by like capital, and like capital
is
not.
Yes.
Yeah. So like, wouldn't it be more corrupt in a fascist state?
No. That would be like the free market. That's different than capitalism. Like when it comes to like individuals, I'm talking about like how politicians are paid for by lobbyists, by these companies, like these billionaires, you know,
yeah.
These millionaires who try to influence them and make them, you know, in office, and then make them vote for laws that will benefit them and not their constituents. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be worse in a fascist state? Because there's only one party to bribe?
Exactly. That is worse. That's horrible.
Then why are you a fascist?
Well, I'm saying it's not worse than a fascist state.
Well,
like,
you just said it was.
Well, yeah, like that's what I don't want. I don't want that stuff. I don't want politicians being loyal to big companies and lobbyists and all that crap. No, it should be for the people and to promote, you know, the people that actually voted for them, that actually care.
But wait, in a fascist society, you wouldn't be voting for anybody. Right?
Kind of, but no.
Are you talking like an authoritarian state like China, where like you vote within the one-party system?
Oh, no.
For delegates that are like selected by the party? Or what are you talking about?
Yeah, like that would be communism, but communism.
Well, I mean, China's not communist. They're an authoritarian state capitalist society.
Oh, yeah, I guess so.
So you basically want like a China state? Or a China-like state, I should say?
I'd say more of a Spain state, but.
But Spain's like a social democracy.
No, I mean, like, back in the day, like, when they used to be fascist.
Oh. I mean...
Yeah, like, okay, China is scary. I don't even want to get into China. Got a lot to say about that.
But it seems like that's what you would want, though. Because you said you wanted a one-party system.
Yes,
you wanted, you wanted state capitalism? Or something like that? It seems really what you want is it like a China-like system.
Well, considering what China is now, they are kind of scary.
Wait, would it not be scary in a fascist society?
I guess that's subjective.
Well, who would it be scary for in a fascist society?
Well, probably leftists.
Why?
Because they want to kill us.
They want to kill...
They're like, oh, I'm a fascist, oh my god, it's so bad. I'm like, well, actually, it's not about racism or an ethnostate. It's literally about social and political organization. You know, it's about a single party state and effective government and effective economics. Like, that's just how it is. And yeah, sure, I suppose you could say that China is kind of like that.
Yeah, right? Like, they suppress any kind of dissent. Sometimes violently, as we saw in, like, Hong Kong. Or they can disappear their billionaires. Why do you think that that's preferable, though, to, like, a democratic society? Where we, like, address, you know, capitalism.
Because I don't like the fact that there are multiple parties who could vote on the budget and shut down the government and stop the budget from actually happening. They cannot fund the military. They can't fund Social Security.
They've been doing that pretty successfully, like, for hundreds of years.
Well, how? No, they haven't, though. Not here. Here in America.
Wait, is the military not being funded right now?
It was last year. That's good.
Yeah.
But how many times, in your lifetime, mm-hmm. has the American government been literally shut down for weeks?
I mean, the only time I can remember was, like, maybe, like, 5 to 6 years ago. But it didn't really impact my life at all. Like, I just couldn't go to some state parks. Why is this, like, a big issue for you? Like, the government shutting down.
That's not the biggest issue. It's just one. It's just one of those issues.
Oh. But, like, and also, why is it a big issue?
Well, of course it's a big issue, but... Okay. Once you have one leader in government, right? Like, he wants to do something. Maybe he's going to, fund such and such, or maybe stop a war or do whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, the Senate, you know, because they're not his political party,
mm-hmm.
they're going to disagree with him.
Yeah,
they have to vote on this, and it's this bureaucracy. It's this nonsense.
Yeah,
that's just stumbles upon
Can I ask though, what happens if you have a senator or like an individual within this bureaucracy who has a really, really bad idea? Like, are there not instances where, like, a fascist state would really backfire if the people in control of the apparatuses in it were, like, horrendously incompetent?
Right. Well, I mean, that wouldn't obviously exist.
Wait, why wouldn't that exist?
Because whoever's the dissenter would just be purged. Like,
right.
It's easy as
that. So wouldn't that just mean, like, if you get somebody in charge of the entire thing who has bad ideas, it just allows them to enforce bad ideas with no recourse?
No, it's not about bad ideas. It's about effective government and just...
But wait, what if the person in charge has ineffective ideas?
Ineffective?
Yeah, like, if your whole point is, like, effective government, I guess I would ask, like, what effective at doing what? and what happens when the person who's in charge of it is, like, really incompetent or has different goals than what, like, you know, might benefit the general people.
If the leader's incompetent, of course, you know, they're not gonna be in government anymore.
Why not?
Because it wouldn't work. Like, what do you mean?
Well, I mean, have you studied history at all?
I went to college and I have a double major in history and political science. So yes, awesome. I have.
Okay, well, so, like, then you know that, like, the Middle Ages were full of people who had, like, called absolute monarchs, who had, like, total control.
Monarchists.
Yeah, who had total control over their governments. And you know that sometimes there were monarchs who had really good ideas and their nations flourished, and sometimes there were monarchs who had really bad ideas and their nations suffered. So, like, what happens when a fascist leader surrounds himself with sycophants who only agree with him because everyone else got purged? And if that person has bad ideas, what happens?
Well, they get overthrown. We already know this.
Oh, wait.
We've seen the French Revolution.
Yeah, but
a lot of that.
Why are you advocating for a system of government that would need to be overthrown instead of just, like, a democratic system that could change itself without the need for killing people?
No, it's not about... It's not a monarchy.
But, I mean, it kind of is, though, right?
It's not feudalism.
It's centralized power in, like, one party where you purge anyone who dissents with your policies. So if the policies are bad and you're purging anyone who disagrees with them...
Wouldn't you say the same thing about communism?
Look
at Stalin.
I would say the same about authoritarian state capitalism. Yeah. I'm not pro-authoritarian. So, like, yeah, I don't like Stalin. I don't like Mao. I'm a socialist, but I'm a libertarian socialist. I believe in maximizing the amount of freedom that people enjoy.
Okay. So, Would that be more of like Sweden or Finland?
It'd be similar, but I think that the best route forward would be to adopt market socialism, whereby you slowly transition to a predominantly worker co-op model of government. And by doing that, worker co-ops would essentially shift the balance of power in this country away from capital owners to the people, because the people would own the capital. And I think that would generally improve everyone's quality of life. And by improving everyone's quality of life, people can enjoy more freedom and live happier, more productive lives. I think, like, the data we have on worker co-ops is pretty convincing that worker co-ops are, like, superior to private business. They allow people more, like, time off. They allow people to, like, actually democratically participate in their companies, and generally are more efficient and have happier workers too. And so,
that's more like along the lines of, like, a Marxist-Leninism theory.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, by doing that, yeah, like, the people control the means of production, but, like,
exactly.
I think when people say, like, people seizing the means of production, people think of, like, a violent revolution, and that's not what I advocate for. I'm advocating for, like, things that we already have, but doing more of them. Because, like, we already have democratic worker co-ops in this country, so let's just make more of those.
Don't know if that's gonna be, like, as... It does look good on paper. Now, of course, you know, you've heard this saying before, socialism looks good on paper and all that.
Yeah.
But in something like the United States with 325 million people, it's a little bit difficult to kind of implement that.
Well, yeah, but I mean, that's why I'm not, like, advocating for, like, a Thanos snap to make the country into, like, a socialist utopia. Like, the things I advocate for are, like, not utopian by any means. Like, what I'm saying is, like, hey, let's have a federal loan program that makes it easier for workers to get capital together to start worker co-ops. Because you know what worker co-ops don't do when they're democratic? They don't vote to move their factory overseas. They don't vote to, cut their own wages or fire people so that the CEO can make, like, $100 million more dollars that year.
Whoa! Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so why didn't you vote for Trump then? Because that's exactly what he was saying. That's why he got rid of NAFTA.
No. That has nothing to do with worker co-ops.
Yes, it does, though. Because all these people, all these CEOs who are taking their companies overseas, they're using slave labor in China.
But that's because these companies are privately owned. They're private businesses.
And so they
follow the incentives of capitalism.
Yeah, so what though?
When workers own the means of production and it's democratic, workers won't collectively say, yeah, let's move our factory to China out of the American Midwest. That sounds like a good idea.
Or what if we just move the companies back to the country that we live in so that our own people can work there and have a better living? I mean,
That doesn't address the underlying problems of capital, though. Like, the workers would still be mistreated by capital, just maybe slightly less so. I don't know. It doesn't seem like that would benefit capital owners. It seems like that would do the opposite of benefiting capital owners.
I think it would benefit them. Well, no, it wouldn't. It would not benefit them.
Yeah.
You know why, though? That's because
they would have to pay their workers more.
To China. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And that's why a $15 minimum wage is stupid, and we shouldn't have that.
Wait, so instead of Chinese workers being underpaid, you want American workers to be underpaid?
No, I want American workers to be paid. I want them to be employed and actually have jobs and be beneficial to our economy.
Wouldn't it be good if we could do that, but also give them democratic control over their workplaces?
What do you mean democratic control? I mean, like, what if you owned a business and you had like 100 employees?
Yeah.
And then your employees were like, oh, I want to just take all of your money. Why would you do that?
Well, so typically how a democratic worker co-op works is that periodically, maybe like once per quarter, like, you know how like private businesses meet for shareholder meetings? Democratic worker co-ops do the same thing, except the shareholders are the employees at the company, the people who work there. And much like a shareholder meeting, where shareholders dictate where the company is going to go for the next quarter to get the most profits, employees get together to dictate the democratic worker co-ops policies for the next quarter. So that could be, hey, you know what? We don't have enough money to pay you all the same unless we fire some people or slash your paycheck by a couple dollars a week.
Right.
Well, vote. So you guys get to vote on which you would prefer. Rather than some asshole in a suit coming down and telling you, sorry, we're cutting half of your department and you're going to have to work overtime to make it up. We aren't going to pay you overtime, by the way.
Yeah. Well, what if they can't pay their employees because there's a mandate that says, oh, it has to be $15 an hour.
Well, then they fail. But then they fail like any other business would if it can't compete.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there you go. I mean, I'm not saying like that happens all the time. It depends. Like, there's a lot of big companies out there, but there's also a bunch of like small, like, you know, mom and pop businesses.
Yeah. Don't you like mom and pop businesses?
Yeah. Like.
Yeah.
Let's say like there's some deli like, you know, on the corner of I don't know, like in New York City or something, and now all of a sudden, oh, you have to pay $15 an hour, and they have like 5 employees, and they can't afford it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what do you do? Yeah, you gotta fire people.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, well, why are you firing me? How dare you, you evil business owner?
But that happens with private business, too.
But they can't, though. That's what I'm saying.
Right, so why not have a superior business model?
I would say lower the minimum wage.
How does that help people?
Because small business owners won't be able to fire people.
But, like, most people in the United States only have $400 extra to spend in their savings account, like, right now. So if you pay them less, we're going to have even less money circulating in the general economy. That's not good.
Well, if you pay them less, I mean, the value of the dollar would be more.
Why?
It would be worth more.
Well, but you're paying them less. Where do you think the profits of paying them less go?
No. If you pay people less, like the minimum wage, if the minimum wage just stayed the same, of course, this does depend regionally. Obviously, like, if you live in New York or California, you know, like all those really expensive places.
Mm-hmm.
That would be beneficial. But the value of the dollar is actually a lot more in like other places like Missouri, Alabama,
yeah,
Oklahoma,
yeah,
Wisconsin. Yeah.
Do you know why?
Way more. Yeah, of course I do.
Because the wealthy people live in those coastal areas. They don't live in Missouri.
Yeah, so why should the entire country have a $15 minimum wage? Like, that doesn't make sense.
Well, I mean, because the minimum wage hasn't increased in, like, 4 decades. And, like, as you pointed out, the value of the dollar is going down. So
because
like you realize like if the minimum wage had kept track with like productivity in this country, the average wage would be over $100,000. Instead, it's at $33,000. Who do you think is pocketing all that extra money from the productivity?
That depends, like, on what job you have.
Oh yeah, of course it
does.
You work. But we're talking averages.
Okay, so averages, $100,000. No, I don't think it would be $100,000, unless you're accounting for inflation. Then maybe it would be.
Yeah, I mean, why wouldn't you account for inflation?
Okay, so $100,000,
mm-hmm,
right, a year. If every person had, what, $15 an hour, and they worked, like, 9 to 5?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
Yeah. Well, what I'm telling you is that if we had continued raising the minimum wage along with productivity, that's where it would be now. And that's not me saying it, by the way. That's the Rand Institute. So, like, an economic policy research center.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. So, like, the issue doesn't seem to be that we couldn't. It just seems to be that rich people don't want to pay their workers more.
I know, but, like, when it comes down to it, what do you mean, like, by rich?
Well, like, I mean the people who own capital. So, capitalists.
Okay, so, let's say you own a pizzeria.
Mm-hmm.
You got 4 employees, and now, you know, you were paying them $8.75 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I used to get paid.
Mm-hmm.
When I used to work at my last job. But now all of a sudden... Oh! $15! Okay!
Mm-hmm.
What if they can't afford it, though? Like, they're not super rich.
Right. Do you acknowledge that there might be like a lot more companies in this country that could afford it than the ones that can't?
Oh yeah, sure, like Walmart and Amazon.
Yeah.
Target. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's, and you actually think that's a good thing?
No, but I think those are
large companies.
I think those large companies are a symptom of capitalism, and that we should address the underlying issue of capitalism to fix the issue.
Right, right. So that's why we shouldn't raise the minimum wage, because you know, smaller companies, like regular people just trying to live their lives, they're not going to be able to afford this. And
do you want to know what my solution would be?
What?
You allow these small mom and pop operations to transition into worker co-ops and give them additional funding for being worker co-ops. So then instead of like you owning the pizzeria, making the decision on how much to pay all of the employees, all of you can come together to decide on what everyone gets compensated based on their work.
What about rent? What about utilities?
Yeah.
What about, like, you know,
well, so like
the,
I mean, your
necessities.
You're talking to a socialist, so like my solutions to those would be decommodifying them and making them like available to everyone who needs them.
I don't think like the regular, like, you know, 19-year-old employee who just got out of college is going to be like, oh, I want to get like the means of production. No.
Do you not think like a 19-year-old just out of college who's getting hired for a full-time job would want to have some say in how their job is done?
Of course they could. Yeah.
Yeah,
sure.
In a democratic worker co-op, they have an equal say in what happens to them at the company.
Tell that to like the 130 companies all over the place.
Yeah. Well, so
in the United States.
Yeah, like I agree. It would be a tough pill to swallow, but my idea is essentially that we have a federal loan program that allows workers to get together and start worker co-ops. So we have more competition, which is good. And then on the flip side, if a company fails and needs the government to bail it out, then they have to agree to transition to a worker co-op to get that bailout. Like the fact that we bailed out Boeing for like billions of dollars, I think that's borderline criminal, right?
Yeah, that was pretty messed up. And I don't know why in the crap that even happened. That was messed up.
So I think it actually makes more sense to invest in these worker co-ops, because worker co-ops don't have the same incentive that like private businesses do to essentially like hide their money in offshore accounts. I think it's much harder to democratically say like, hey, company, do you want us to do crimes? I think that's much harder to do in a democratic worker co-op.
Whoa. Okay. Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
Yeah. So it actually would mean that we get more return on our investment as like, you know, people who are making the government making this loan.
Yeah. Yeah. Honestly, I think one of the biggest crimes was when J.P. Morgan, they were messed up back in 2008, and then they were bailed out for billions of dollars.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're fine.
Yeah. I would love it if instead they were now a worker co-op and their workers were having better conditions and they were fully paying their taxes.
That would be nice. But
yeah.
They're not.
I know, but that's why I think my plan would be good.
Okay.
And I think generally this addresses maybe a lot of the concerns you have with a democracy in a way that doesn't like put us into fascism where like there are people getting purged and stuff.
Oh, no. This is different, because like, you know, economics and, you know, political organization, totally different.
There's no relation between the two in your mind?
Well, there is, but like not in this context. No.
Why would there be no relation?
Well, because like right now, you know, we're just talking about like how, you know, economic policy, like how that would work.
Yeah. But like you realize like it would also be really harder for a democratic worker co-op to be like, hey, let's pay a bunch of people to go to Washington, D.C. and bribe our officials. Right? Like that would be hard to democratically pass, right?
Well, that's not either economics or fascism or socialism.
But
that's
like,
just corruption.
Right. Well, I mean, no, it's not just corruption. That's capitalism, baby. The reason companies pay lobbyists is because they get a return on that investment, right?
Talking about that, I mean, like billions. Unfortunately, yeah.
That's the job of a lobbyist. They get returns for their company.
Yeah, they did, and Obama totally fell for that.
For sure. And so did Trump. Trump bailed out Boeing. Like, and that's the fundamental issue. This is why socialists don't like Obama or Trump. Because both of them serve the interests of capital, and what's really screwing us over is capital, not really politicians. The politicians are aesthetically different, but that's mostly it.
Yeah. Well, this is why I don't like democracy, and I think that voting is just an illusion of freedom, and it's
But
just
wait,
stupid.
Wait, wouldn't it make voting matter if you didn't have lobbyists, like, pouring billions of dollars into your election?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So wouldn't
if
you address the capitalism problem, wouldn't that make democracy work in a much better way than something, say, like fascism, where you have to like kill people who disagree with your policy?
Wow. Never said that.
Well,
no.
Wait, you said purge. What is the difference between purging or killing
people? Not killing people. Jeez, that's crazy.
Is it, though?
No.
That's usually where fascists go with purge. It's usually the connotation of purge.
Well, purge, I guess, would be like firing people.
Then why didn't you just say firing people?
We're really going to get into semantics? Okay, fine. Firing people. How's that?
I mean, like, you realize, like, when you're like, I'm a fascist, and then you say, like, I would purge people who disagree with my policy, like, that has certain connotations. So I just wanted to be clear. Not trying to, like,
out. So, no, it's all good. So, let's say, like, if I was in government, then, yeah, I would fire people who have, you know, the wrong ideas, obviously.
Wait, what? If you were firing people, you would have the wrong ideas?
No. I would fire those who did.
Oh.
Like, for instance,
how do you determine who has wrong ideas?
Okay. Let's say if there was some crazy dude who wanted to go to war with North Korea,
mm-hmm.
I would be like, whoa. You serious right now?
Mm-hmm.
Chill the crap out. Let's either talk about this or no. I'm gonna get someone else who doesn't wanna do that.
Okay. But like, what if you weren't the one in charge and instead the person in charge was like, yes, attacking North Korea is a great idea.
Oh God, I hope not.
But again, like, it seems like in a democracy where you've addressed the corruption of capitalism, that, like, you would instead be able to have, like, discourse and find out what the majority of people in the country would actually want and what would actually benefit them, instead of having, like, a one-party system that gives one person or a small group of people the ability to fuck over an incredibly large number of people.
Oh, no, of course not. That's the whole idea of having a single party system. fact that there are multiple parties, unfortunately, in the system that we currently live in, that nothing gets done. And it's like, half the country.
But wait, would you want things to get done if they were bad or the wrong things?
What? No.
Yeah, so like, what happens if the fascist government doesn't conform to what you think is, like, right? Because, like, I think that's one of the main advantages of democracy, right? Is that in a democracy, you can settle these things through, like, discourse and, like, having a conversation about it. Whereas in fascism, if, like, somebody disagrees, they get fired. And then, like, what's their recourse? Because, like, earlier you said, like, the only option would be to, like, overthrow the government. And that doesn't seem like a really good political system to me.
No, not overthrowing the government. No, of course not. Just
So, like, how would people express their dissent to the one party system that has essentially total control over the government?
Well, this is what I was saying earlier about Spain when they were under fascism under Francisco Franco. He allowed all kinds of protests against the government, you know, freedom of speech, mm-hmm. all that. But yeah, it was a single party state. You know, it was efficient. It was fine.
I mean, what was
but
it?
But yeah, yes, it was.
Because like, if I remember, they fought a civil war over it. Seems like most people
back in like the 1930s, yeah.
It seems like most people didn't like the fascism.
No, that was back in like the 1920s, 1930s, yeah. thereabouts. But back in up until the 1970s at least, Spain was a fascist government, but they also allowed all kinds of free speech. And yeah, you know, people could.
But isn't again? Isn't that
their different ideas
dependent on the people who are in power? Like the tolerance of free speech only extends so far as like the people in power allow it.
Yeah, but they did though, and it was fine.
But like, you understand how I made the comparison earlier to like monarchy, and like there were some monarchies that were like relatively good to their people and those countries flourished, but then yeah. like because it's a monarchy, the next person in line was a complete dipshit and the entire country like collapsed on itself. So like, how would a fascist state prevent that from happening? Because it seems like if you put people in positions of power who can just fire everyone who disagrees with them, that then they can enforce bad policies that lead the country to collapse or become embroiled in like a violent revolution, because there's no recourse to change the government otherwise.
Well, there is. Like, that would depend on the individual who's technically in charge, but this does depend like on each country and or state where this exists.
Right, but that's my point. It depends on an individual.
It's not just one right. Exactly. So it's not just one person. There's always a council. You know, there's other people, a whole cabinet, if you will. You know, advisors, all that. Hell, even in China right now, yeah, there's Xi Jinping.
Mm-hmm.
But he's not entirely in charge. Like, there's a lot of people who kind of like around him that run the military.
Yeah, like a bunch of unaccountable people who pull the strings. Yeah,
well, unaccountable, I suppose.
Yeah,
I suppose
that's kind of my issue. Like, why would you want a system where there's like a small group of unaccountable people who have all of the power in the country, and like people have to live under like a totalitarian state? Like, why would you want that? Or are you like under the impression you would be one of the people at the top?
Oh no, well, I didn't say that.
But, like, otherwise, why would you want to live in, like, I don't know, like, a complete surveillance state where, like, you could be vanished if people really don't like what you're saying?
Well, don't say the wrong things.
Yeah, or but, what if they just don't like you? Because of who you are, what you look like, or... I don't know, you gave someone at a diner the impression that you didn't like them and that turned out to be one of the unaccountable people, you know?
That's not how crazy it gets.
I mean, it can,
That's not what it's about.
But wait, if you have unaccountable people, what's preventing them from doing that to you?
I suppose, legitimate courts?
Why would there be legitimate courts in a fascist government? Why would fascists have legitimate courts?
Well, because there would be. You know, it's not...
But wait, the fascists control, like, the courts.
Right.
Yeah, so why would they be legitimate? Would they not be in some way biased towards, like, people who are accepted by the party?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There would be laws. There would be order. You know, it's not like, oh, we don't like you because you made a mean face at a restaurant. That's not.
Yeah, but you realize
what
like
I'm saying.
You realize like even right now in like the United States, if a cop decides they want to like arrest you and charge you with a crime, like they can make up all kinds of stuff. Oh, you were resisting arrest? Well, we're gonna arrest you and charge you with a crime. Or like, hey, they can plant illegal drugs on you. Like this happens right now. So like, what prevents that from happening in a fascist state in a way to silence fascist enemies or enemies of the state?
That's a very good question.
Yeah. Like, well, I mean, like, the fascists control all the levers of power, so, like, what,
right.
You have no recourse to, like, make the courts impartial. Or even attempt to make the courts impartial,
yeah,
really.
Yeah, you kind of do, though, because I'm not talking about, like, the whole Nazi state or anything crazy
that. You're talking about a fascist state. I get it. You're not talking about Nazis.
Yeah. Right, so... With fascism, that doesn't mean that all of the police are completely against you, all the courts are against you. There are reasonable people,
right,
who are judges and jury, and if you committed a crime or something, mm-hmm, they'll be like, okay, well, maybe you're innocent, maybe you're guilty, I don't know.
Yeah, but, like, do you not see how, like, judges having been like endorsed by the party in order to become judges would then not want to jeopardize their own position to go against what like the party wants them to rule on a certain case? Like they might have discretion on like a parking ticket or something, or like, you know, like a random murders, but like if the party really doesn't want someone around, like they can make sure that judge gives the right.
I'm not thinking that the party, you know, completely controls literally everyone and everything.
Wait,
like,
but you said you wanted a totalitarian state.
Yeah,
that,
I do.
That's what, like, a totalitarian state is.
Right, but that doesn't mean that every single individual is going to just judge you like that. Could you imagine, like, just... getting a parking ticket and going to jail for like 10 years? I mean, that's a little crazy.
Yeah, but I mean, like, have you seen China? Like, China does that, and we agreed at the beginning of the conversation that it's very similar to what you would want.
No, China, oh my god, oh my goodness, they're scary.
Yeah, but like, what prevents, like, the court systems from being operating in a similar way? Because, like, the courts over there operate in a way to appease, like, the Communist Party of China, right? So, like, how would a fascist like court system be any different?
You know what? It probably wouldn't.
Yeah.
I guess you just have to be really careful.
But I mean, you understand how, like, I guess we'd have to just be really careful would be like a not a very good argument for your, like, system of government, right?
Nah, I wouldn't say that.
Wait, why wouldn't it? Like, there's literally no checks and balances against abuses like this.
Yeah, of course it would be.
Like,
yeah,
what?
It would.
Wait, how would what recourses would judges have against the state?
Well, a constitution.
Oh,
there's
wait.
That.
So you do want a constitution?
Well, yeah, of course.
Okay. What if one of the leaders of the fascist party wants to violate the constitution?
Well, I guess they're going to get prosecuted.
What if they're able to pressure, you know, the court system? Because
well, like I said earlier,
if the leaders of the courts disagree, they can be fired.
Yeah, if they're a member of the party, then
yeah.
Sure.
Well, but wait, they wouldn't become like a member of a high court without like being a member of the party. Surely, there's only one party.
Sure, they would be. Yeah, why not?
Wait, you said there was only one party.
Well, yeah, but that doesn't mean that you can't just get a job. I mean,
well,
right?
We're not talking about just any job. We're talking about, you know, judges. We're talking about a branch of the government, right?
Yeah, but
so what? Why would the party not have influence over the judges?
Well, even in our own country now, there are judges who are independents, libertarians.
Yeah.
They're not affiliated with anybody.
Yeah. Because we live in a democracy with, you know, parties and like a plurality of political thought.
Well, democracy is stupid. But so they went to
I agree,
to
it can
law
be
school.
Stupid sometimes.
They went to law school, they just wanted this job, you know, they're either a lawyer, a
mm-hmm.
judge, or all of that.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so like
so what,
it's not everybody.
But like what happens when like, you know, there's a case coming up and someone in a nice suit, you know, arrives at their door and says, "Hey, in this next case, you're going to find the defendant guilty." Or and I hope you have a really nice night, and then leaves. You know, after flashing like a badge of like the party. You know, what
oh boy. Like I guess it depends on how much money they have to bribe them in
yeah,
that situation.
So, I mean, it seems like you're setting up a system of government that is extremely prone to corruption and also has, like, a government apparatus that can have complete control over the courts to squash dissent. Doesn't
yeah,
seem good.
Yeah, exactly. I think the multiple party state is absolutely worse because it's not only just
but,
their
But wait. Again, what happens if you are in that system and you don't agree with the ruling party? What happens? What can you do? And I'm asking you as like a fascist. Like you live
right.
in that society. You're
yes.
not a high-ranking member of the party. You're just a normal person on the street. The fascist party, you might yourself be a fascist, but the fascist party in power is making what you would term wrong decisions.
Okay, so
when it comes to
this
efficacy
is, this
or
is a,
civil
a
rights.
A really hypothetical thing. So
yeah.
what is the crime? Like, what did I do?
I'm just saying, like, you live in this society as, like, a normal person. How do you voice what you want your government to do? Because it seems like you're setting up a system where people are just passively accepting what the government tells them to do. And you hope and pray that the people who are in charge of that government are, you know, like, good at their jobs and aren't going to abuse their power. Despite the fact that, like,
so.
You would still have capitalism So you would still have ultra wealthy elites who can bribe pretty much any official.
Yep.
So, like, what are the benefits of this system, I guess? Or, like, how do you enact change from you being, you know, a relatively normal person?
Well, as any normal person, I wouldn't have to enact change. I mean, I could just live my life, you know.
How?
Buy a house.
Wait,
you know,
what if they're like, we don't want you to buy that house? We're gonna, because we are gonna bulldoze it, to make some, you know, I don't know, fascist town square. I don't know. I mean, like, you're dealing with like a bureaucracy, right? And they can just say no, and they don't have to tell you why.
No, that's not.
Why not?
Okay.
Not right now.
Well, no, this is getting a little crazy.
Well, but, like, that's kind of the issue, though, isn't it? Like, it is getting a little crazy, but what's to prevent your setup from getting a little crazy, right? It seems like it only depends on who's in charge and, like, the goodwill of the fascist party to not corrupt the courts and not accept bribes. Which doesn't seem like a good system to prevent taking bribes or from...
That happens in socialism, that happens in capitalism. It's all over the damn place.
Wait, what would you describe as, like, a socialist state? Where, like, the workers own the means of production?
That would be the primary definition.
Yeah, so what state would that be?
Well, really want to get into this?
I mean, like, what? I just want to know, like, which state you think exists where workers own the means of production.
Well, it used to be North Korea, actually, back in like the 1950s, 1960s.
Mm-hmm.
And Union back in 1935.
Do you think that's the case now, or was the case for the majority of those countries' existences?
Oh yeah, absolutely. That was definitely the case. Like that's why they had the revolution. Like that's why they wanted to have.
Or did
a socialist
workers
government.
Do what the government told them to do?
Well, they did under Stalin.
Yeah.
There's
so
that.
Does that mean that the workers controlled the means of production, or did the government control the means of production?
Well, the workers did in North Korea in like the 1950s.
Yeah, for a very brief window.
Exactly.
And then do you
and
know
then,
what happened?
How did socialism work out? Yeah. Kind of fucked everyone over now, didn't it?
Are you saying that they're socialist now, or are you saying that they got taken over by a fascist?
Well, they're Juche now.
Well, yeah. But...
Well, North Korea is, but Russia is kind of... They're their own thing. It's basically a dictatorship under Putin. He's not a true fascist, though.
Yeah, but he is an authoritarian.
Yeah, he is.
So, like, this is my problem, because, like, when a lot of people bring up, like, oh, China's communist, like, again, I have to point out, like, if the workers really controlled their means of production, would they need suicide nets outside of their factories? Probably not.
That is a very good point, Jack.
Yeah. And I,
yeah, you're damn right.
And
I
I think issues like that are very similar to, like, workers under Stalin or workers in the DPRK. Like, I am highly skeptical that the terms under which they were working were really the workers owning the means of production,
so
given their conditions.
Are you going to say that socialism, it wasn't the right socialism, you know, at that time?
Wait, are you going to imply that, like, capitalism immediately worked the first time it was tried?
Well, I think it did.
Really?
But well, okay, not the first time. definitely not the first time when they had like child slave labor in factories, but that was all that.
But that was still capitalism. Like, slavery can happen under capitalism.
Well, yeah, of course.
Yeah. So, like, child labor also happens under capitalism, too.
That's what I was saying, yeah. Like, the whole railroad, Carnegie. Oh, boy, yeah. All that crazy stuff.
So, like, but my point being that, like, I think that there were some revolutionaries who had good intentions, but the revolutions didn't plan out. Because, like, the whole point of, like, revolution versus evolution is workers, like, you know, controlling the state and using the state as an apparatus to transition to socialism. But in, you know, places like Russia and China and, you know, North Korea, they seized control over the state, but they never actually transitioned to the point where workers had control over the means of production.
Well, it's interesting, you know, like I've read up a lot about Marxist theory,
mm-hmm.
about how socialism transitions into communism when it comes to like a utopian society, and it's really fascinating, and that's exactly what Lenin wanted to do when the whole Bolsheviks when they took over Russia in 1917,
mm-hmm.
but they never got there,
right? Because Stalin came into power and said, "Hey, we control the state, and this is what socialism is." And that's not what socialism has ever meant. It doesn't mean having control over the state. It means workers controlling the means of production. I just advocate for, you know, a means of doing that via evolutionary politics, working within democracy to change. To change the status quo away from capital and to favor workers instead. Because I think that addresses most of the, like, issues we have with, like, democracy, most of the inefficiencies we have with democracy, and, you know, makes everyone happier, more free, and I think that's a good thing.
Yeah, it would be if we lived in, like, Athens.
Wait, why would living in Athens make a difference?
Well, that's the birthplace of democracy.
Yeah, but like, I mean,
they thought that like every vote mattered, but I don't think it does.
Wait, do you not think like rich people in Athens had like influence over politics?
Oh yeah, of course they did.
Yeah,
but
so like,
but one person's vote really doesn't matter, though.
Right, but that, I mean, that's true under all democracies.
Yeah, that's why democracy is stupid.
But my point is, I think we should give people the opportunity to participate in democracy. I think that is its redeeming trait, right? Allowing people to peacefully change their government is a pretty revolutionary concept. And I think that's a good thing. I think it's a good thing to be able to peacefully transition to different policies and change and adapt to new conditions as they arise.
Okay.
And I think that that's something that fascism is not equipped to do as much. Because again, like, if you're in a democracy and you want to change the government, you can vote. If you're under a fascist totalitarian state and you want to change the government, your only option is violently overthrowing the government.
Yeah.
And, like, it seems like you're kind of banking on the kind of fascism that you would luck into would be the kind of fascism that agrees with what you agree with. But that might not necessarily be the case, which I think kind of makes it, like, not a good argument.
Alright, if you say so.
Yeah. Well, do you have any last memes? We've been talking for a while. But I'd love to talk to you again sometime.
Oh, absolutely. This has been awesome.
Yeah.
Love talking to you. No, I hope you have a great night. I'll just keep on watching your stream. Hope you have some really more interesting colors.
Yeah. Nice talking with you.
All right. You have a good night.
See ya.